The human heart is a very important component of our cardiovascular system, and that's because it creates the hydrostatic pressure that is needed to actually move all that blood through the blood vessels of our body. Now, let's begin by discussing what the structure of the heart is. Now, the heart is an organ that is located inside a protective covering, a protective sac we call the pericardial sac, or simply the pericardium. Now, as we'll see in just a moment, the pericardium actually consists of two different layers. And the function of the pericardium is not only to protect the heart from physical damage, it's to also lubricate the heart, and it's to also attach the heart to other parts of our body. So to actually examine what the pericardium looks like, let's take a cross-section of the heart. We get the following diagram. So we have the blood vessels around the heart. We have the four chambers of the heart shown here. We have the actual heart shown in red, and we have this protective covering found outside the heart. This is the pericardium. Now, if we zoom in on this segment of this diagram, we get the following blown up image. And this consists of the pericardium. So this entire layer right here, not including this red layer, is the pericardium. The red layer, as we'll see in just a moment, is the actual heart itself. So let's begin with the pericardium. We can divide the pericardium into two layers. We have the outer layer and the inner layer. The outer layer is shown in purple in the following diagram. And the outer layer consists of strong fibrous proteins that give our pericardium its strength. So the outer layer is responsible for not only attaching the heart to different parts of the body, but it also protects the heart from physical damage. Now, the inner portion of the pericardium is also known as the inner serous layer. And serous comes from the word serum, because this section actually contains of a fluid that resembles serum. Now, our inner serous layer can actually be subdivided into two regions. We have the parietal and the visceral layer. Now, the parietal layer of the inner pericardium is this orange layer right here, while the visceral layer of the inner pericardium is this inner layer of our pericardium shown in orange. And this space between the visceral and the parietal layer of the inner pericardium is known as the pericardial space, or the pericardial cavity. And this contains the pericardial fluid. And that fluid lubricates our heart, decreasing the friction that the heart feels every time it actually contracts. So together, these two layers of the pericardium protect the heart, they attach the heart to other parts of the body, and they lubricate the heart. Now, let's move on to the actual heart itself. So if we examine this red segment of the heart, this segment actually consists of three individual layers. So the heart can be divided into three layers. We have the epicardium, the outermost layer. We have the myocardium, the middle layer. And we have the inner layer of the heart, known as the endocardium. So this layer, the epicardium, is actually physically attached. It's fused with our visceral layer of the inner pericardium. So this visceral layer of the inner pericardium is attached to the epicardium, this layer of the heart. And together, these two layers play a role in lubricating our heart along with the fluid found within the pericardial cavity. Now, the thickest segment of the heart is the myocardium, and this is the middle portion. This consists of specialized heart cells known as myocytes, also known as cardiac muscle cells. And these are the cells that are responsible for contracting and creating that hydrostatic pressure that is needed to pump all that blood through all the blood vessels of our body. Now, the innermost portion of the heart that is in direct contact with the blood of our chambers found inside the chambers of the heart, this is known as the endocardium. And the endocardium consists of endothelial cells of simple squamous endothelial cells that are in direct contact with the blood found inside our chambers. So once again, the heart can be broken down into three layers. So we have our epicardium, we have the myocardium, and we have the endocardium. And these three layers form four different chambers inside our heart. So now let's focus on the four different chambers. Now, the entire heart can actually be broken down into two pumps. So if we are examining our body from this image, from this direction, we have the right side and we have the left side. Now, the heart is found inside this section right to the left of our sternum bone. Now, we have the left side of the heart, this segment, and the right side of the heart. The right side, so this section right over here, consists of our right pump. And the left side, this segment over here, consists of our left pump. And each one of these pumps consists of two chambers. We have the atrium and we have the ventricle. Now, the atrium is the chamber that receives our blood from the rest of our body, and the ventricle receives the blood from the atrium and it pumps the blood to the organs, tissues, and cells of our body. So the heart consists of two pumps that are connected in series next to one another. We have the right pump and we have the left pump, and each pump contains an atrium and our ventricle. So let's take a look at the right atrium. The right atrium receives deoxygenated blood from the systemic circulation of our cardiovascular system, from the organs, the tissues, and cells of our body. Now, once the blood fills the right atrium, it then moves into the right ventricle. And it's the right ventricle that is responsible for creating that contraction and moving that deoxygenated blood into the pulmonary circulation of the cardiovascular system, into these pulmonary arteries that extend into the left lung and into the right lung. So we have the left lung here and we have the right lung here. Now, once our blood is inside the lung, it is oxygenated and then it moves into our left atrium via the pulmonary vein. So this is the left atrium. The left atrium, once it fills with blood, it moves into the left ventricle, and it's the left ventricle that is the thickest of all these chambers. It contains the thickest layer of myocardium, and that means it can create the highest hydrostatic pressure, and that is important because it's this ventricle that is responsible for moving all that blood into the aorta and all the different organs and tissues and cells of our body. So we have the right atrium, the right ventricle that make up the right pump of the heart, and we have the left atrium and the left ventricle that make up the left pump of our heart. And these pumps work at the same exact time. And that means when the right pump contracts, the left pump contracts at the same time. And when the right pump relaxes, our left pump relaxes at the same exact time. So when the right ventricle contracts, the left ventricle contracts at the same time. Now, we know that inside our cardiovascular system, the blood actually flows in only one direction. It's very important that the heart actually creates a unidirectional motion of blood. And to ensure that the blood doesn't actually flow backwards inside the heart, we have a system of four different valves found inside our heart. So the heart must be able to pump blood in a unidirectional fashion. And in order to prevent our backflow of blood inside our heart, the heart uses our four different valves. Now, actually, it's two sets of different valves. So we have the atrioventricular valves that connect the atrium and our ventricle, and we also have our semilunar valves, which connect the ventricle to our blood vessels. So let's discuss these four types of valves. So let's take a look at the following diagram. So once again, this is the right atrium. This is our right ventricle. And the valve that connects the right atrium to our right ventricle is number one. This is the right atrioventricular valve, also known as the tricuspid valve. Now, what the function of this valve is the following. During relaxation, valve number one is actually open, and that's to make sure that the blood flows from the right atrium and into our right ventricle. But when this right ventricle is filled with blood, it needs to contract and to prevent the backflow of blood from the right ventricle back to the right atrium. This valve actually closes as a result of pressure, and that ventricle contracts and it pumps blood from the right ventricle and into the pulmonary circulation via these pulmonary arteries that move deoxygenated blood into the left and the right lung. So this is the right atrioventricular valve, valve number one. Now, what about valve number two? So valve number two is this valve here. It basically connects the right ventricle to these pulmonary arteries. So this is known as the pulmonary semilunar valve, or simply the pulmonary valve. Now, when the right ventricle actually relaxes, blood flows from this location to this right ventricle, but at the same time that this valve number one is open, valve number two, the pulmonary valve, has to be closed because we don't want a backflow of blood from the pulmonary arteries back into the right ventricle. But when the right ventricle actually contracts, it moves deoxygenated blood from the right ventricle into the pulmonary arteries, and valve number two, pulmonary valve, is actually open. So when valve number one is open, valve number two is closed, but when valve number one is closed, valve number two is open. Now, what about the left pump of our heart? This consists also of an atrioventricular valve, but this one is known as the left atrioventricular valve, and this one is also known by the name of the mitral valve or the bicuspid valve. Now, what exactly is the point of the left atrioventricular valve? This is valve number three. So when our left ventricle is relaxed, blood flows from the left atrium into the left ventricle. And to make sure this blood flows, this valve number three must be open. But when our left ventricle contracts, valve number three closes to prevent the backflow, the movement of blood, back into the left atrium. Now, what about valve number four? This is known as the aortic valve or the aortic semilunar valve. This is the valve that connects the left ventricle to our aorta and our systemic circulation. So, when the left ventricle is relaxed, it accepts that blood from this left atrium. So valve number three is open, but valve number four, the aortic valve, is closed. But when contraction of the left ventricle takes place, number three closes, but number four, the aortic valve, has to open to allow the movement of our blood into the systemic circulation of the cardiovascular system. So what can we conclude about these four valves? So basically, when relaxation takes place, valve number one and valve number three are open. These are the atrioventricular valves, and they must be open to actually accept that blood from the atrium and into that ventricle. But when contraction takes place, the right and left atrioventricular valves, number one and three, are actually closed, but number two and four, the semilunar valves, we have the pulmonary and the aortic valve. These open up to basically allow the movement of our blood from our heart into the systemic and into the pulmonary circulatory system of our body. So when 1 and 3 are open, 2 and 4 are closed, but when 1 and 3 are closed, 2 and 4 are open. And these work together to ensure that the heart creates a unidirectional flow of our blood, to ensure the blood flows in a single direction from the heart to the organs and then back to our heart.